Carolina Hurricanes lose 4-2 to the Detroit Red Wings in game number 2 of the season. I'm going to try to cover this as positively as humanly possible in this game because there's not a lot of positivity to take out from this game. Few lone bright spots, but this was just a bad, bad hockey game. So let's kick it off with what happened before the game, the lineup changes, and everything like that. To start with, Jordan Staal moves to the COVID-19 protocol list. With the situation with the pandemic and the resumption of, or the start of the season, we're not going to know if Jordan has COVID or if he's been in contact with people who have COVID or he returned a positive test and they wanted to verify. But even into today, Sunday, he is still listed as a COVID-19 protocol player. The confusing aspect that I don't really want to get into is how is Jordan the one player who has it or got in tracing or whatever the case is, and nobody else on the team is, you know, being pulled out as well. We don't know. We probably will never know. We'll just know when Jordan comes off of that list. But as a result of Jordan Staal being out due to that protocol list, Morgan Geekie makes his season debut for the Carolina Hurricanes. Vincent Trocheck moves up a line to the second center spot. I thought this was one of the better moves, and obviously it paid dividends. And Rod Brind'Amour goes back to Peter Mrazek after his game one shutout. First period was pretty quiet, but if you were watching the game, you could tell that Detroit was the faster team, winning a lot of battles to lose pucks. Canes got two early power plays, and Detroit had chances on both of them shorthanded. Again, I mentioned it in the first video. I'll mention it again. That first power play unit is not doing well. I think the power play as a whole right now, not doing well. But specifically, that first unit is having a real tough time. And it seems every single time that the second unit comes out, they actually generate a ton more scoring chances, or at least get closer, even if the shots are over the net or whatever. That's a whole nother thing. Jeez, guys, hit the net. Vladislav Namestnikov had a breakaway chance, a great stop on that by Peter Mrazek. And otherwise, the first period was just very quiet. It was not an effort you wanted to see out of the Canes. They seemingly survived the period by not giving up a shorthanded goal. But they escaped 0-0, and in the second period, I thought, was their better period of game one. So the expectation coming into the second period was that they would get their feet moving, be a little bit better, as they typically are. But early on into the first period, I think it was Philip Zadina behind the net centered a pass out to Bobby Ryan, who scored his first of the year. Kind of a weird bouncing puck. If you know Bobby Ryan, he does shoot hard. He's a good, solid shooter. And of course, his career in Ottawa did not go I think how anybody would have expected, but he's still a sniper at the end of the day. He can still really shoot the puck. He showed that in the 2017 playoffs. He came back last year after battling alcoholism and scored 3 goals in a game. So as much as we looked at Bobby Ryan as that $7.25 million cap hit in Ottawa, that was a bit of an albatross and got bought out, he's still an everyday NHL player, and he definitely showed that in this game. And honestly, I can't hate on Bobby. Honestly, nothing but love and support for Bobby Ryan. He looked great in this game. He looks really good so far. Very fast, a lot lighter on his feet. But while this was happening, this was kind of a momentum killer because the Canes had actually come out and started the period pretty well. But it seemingly after the Bobby Ryan goal, the momentum was gone and the Canes were just flat-footed the rest of the game. It was brought up on the broadcast several times by Mike Maniscalco and Trip Tracy that Detroit was just getting to pucks quicker. They were winning these puck battles and off these draws that maybe they lose or win to a neutral spot, they were the first team to get that puck. All in all, a good solid 5 minutes to start the period, but the other 15 was just burying. Heading into the third period, though, honestly, we got like a little glimmer of hope that this game was going to kind of turn back and the Canes would start playing. Svechnikov gets a goal. Actually, I believe it gets credited to somebody else after the fact. So on the power play, that goal did get credited to Vincent Trocheck. It appears to hit him in front, but the shot by Svechnikov, of course, is what we all want to talk about. Just a great release from him. He, of course, had the empty netter in game one, which that game was very quiet for him, but he was easily the Canes' best player in this one. Dylan Larkin answered back pretty quickly. Just a weird bounce off of a skate. I think it was Brady Shea or Brett Pesce in front. It was one of the two defensemen tying somebody up in front. The puck goes off the skate, and that's just a tough one. A little later in the third, though, Andrei Svechnikov comes around side of the net, or I don't even know, this was just a tremendous play by him, but he comes around, finds the puck, and kind of does a no-look shot that finds its way over Bernier's shoulder, and the game's tied back up. So again, it looks pretty good. There's still some issues here, of course, but hey, in these types of games, if you go into overtime or the shootout and you grab 1 point, I think that's a victory in and of itself. But alas, it's not meant to be. This play, I'm gonna break it down a little bit, because I think a lot of Canes fans would be angry that a penalty was called on a certain player in this, but I'm not angry about that. I'm angry about a different play that happened out in front before the goal happened. There's a play in front while the penalty's being killed off where Jordan Martineau kind of gets like slew-footed, or just gets his legs pulled out from under him. Not only on this same play do you have Fleury, who blocked a shot hurt, you have Martinook, who's now been dumped and fully pulled clean off of his feet. If you've played hockey, you know how much that hurts when it's just your upper body that's able to take the blow, and you can't brace yourself by your arms or your legs. So Martinook, who's already tired after a penalty kill, is now upended. No call on the play, and this leads directly to the goal because Jordan Martinook can't get back in the play because he's hurt. So the game-winning goal goes to Robbie Fabry. And jumping back just a moment to the Shea penalty that led to the power play, I think a lot of fans would look at Philip Ronick and the way he sold the call and jumped and dove. Like, he for sure dove on this play. But I honestly have no issues with him diving or anything like that. My issue is with Brady Shea on this play, because Brady Shea needs to know not to take a stupid slashing penalty after he got cleanly checked along the boards. This is the type of stuff that just drives me nuts. Andrei Svechnikov did this all for the first half of last season. Like, so many times, he would take stupid slashing calls, stupid high-sticking penalties. Why? What's the point of retaliating? It doesn't make any sense, and it only stands to hurt your team. Because of the way the refs ref the game now, the penalty is never going to... If the penalty is not immediately called on the player throwing the hit, the retaliation will always be called. Always. So Brady Shea, who already had a rough game in this one, made it even worse by committing this stupid penalty. Of course, not putting the whole game on him. It was a team effort, and it was a team reason that everybody lost. In the end of the game, the dagger was Dylan Larkin getting a 4-2. He put an empty netter in, similar to how the Canes did in game number one. So we'll wrap up the game, and then we'll get to some tweets. So starting off with the wrap-up, honestly, the issue that plagued this team so often last year, and why after the first five games and after the month of October, this team seemed to just fall off the face of a cliff, is that they don't play a full 60 minutes. I can't recall a game, even in the bubble, even into last season, where they really, really did. Like, where you can definitively point at a game and say they played an entire 60-minute effort, and that's the reason they won, not that they scored three goals in the third period and just coasted the rest of the way. With the same issues that are plaguing them are coming back to bite them again. This is something that's got to come from the coaching staff, Rod Brendamore, and the players have to buy in and stop whatever this is. It's a very weird thing where they don't play for 20 minutes. That 20-minute portion of the game just goes. And then they're playing catch-up because they stop playing for 20 minutes. On a more positive note, this was a very good game for Andrei Svechnikov. Two goals, I guess a goal and an assist after they reviewed it and gave the goal to Vincent Trocheck. And moving Trocheck up that line, I believe it was with Fast on the wing and Svechnikov on the opposite wing of him, it seemed to really benefit Andre a lot more than playing with Jordan Staal in the first game. So I'd like to see this line stay put, stay where it is. When Staal comes back, just to bump Geeky back out of the lineup, and then Staal becomes the third line center. So the first tweet I have up from Schlomes on Twitter: today, no physicality, whiffing on passes, whiffing on shots, losing more than half of the faceoffs, not really threatening Detroit, we look like crap. And yeah, I completely agree with this, because every aspect of the game the Canes lost. The way the Canes played in the first game was just completely different. I didn't even mention it in the video, I didn't write down anywhere. They didn't hit, and that's what they did so much in the first game. They hit people. Jordan Staal was throwing hits. Jake Gardner was even throwing hits. And I talked about how Jake Gardner shouldn't be throwing hits. But in this game, there was no hitting. There just wasn't. They didn't play the body. They didn't do much of anything. And this one from @BrettFinger. Brady Shea gets called for slashing on this play with under 5 minutes to go in a tie game. Philip Ronick with an Oscar-worthy performance. Red Wings score on the ensuing power play, which ultimately makes the difference. terrible call, obviously, but the Hurricanes had every opportunity to not lose this game. The second period in particular was a complete snooze fest for them. And it's interesting because I thought the second period, they started off really well, and that has typically been their good period throughout the season, but this was very clearly just not at all the... It was bad. They played great for the first 5 minutes, and then as soon as that Bobby Ryan goal goes in, it's over for them. Tweet from Alex O'Hari on Twitter. Sorry, but this game didn't come down to goaltending. A missed call, crappy ice, or a bad play here or there. It was a cohesively shitty effort from the entire team, and they simply didn't deserve to win. Gonna have to play much better than that in a tough Central Division. Look, to start off with, the Central Division being tough, that whole thing can be debated across all four divisions, so we're not even gonna touch that. But the cohesively shitty effort part, we will, because I have to agree with Alex here. That was a completely bad effort from top to bottom. It wasn't one line. It wasn't one defensive pairing. It wasn't Peter Mrazek. And honestly, I've been pretty adamant about not liking Peter Mrazek, and he's looked great these first two games. A lot of hatred for Peter Mrazek, and I get blaming a goaltender, but I think if you're blaming a goaltender, you're not watching the rest of the play, and you're only watching the goals. Like, the goal that ultimately eliminated the Canes in the bubble, that goal where Mrazek just had to be tight to his post, that's one where you can blame him. But getting a piece of a, like, powerful Bobby Ryan shot, a defender tipping a puck in your own net, and a nice behind the goal pass to somebody who's wide open in front of the net, most goaltenders are going to let that in. Another tweet here from Alex. If the Canes defend as softly as they did tonight against better teams than Detroit, they're going to surrender more than just three goals, and it won't be the goalie's fault then either. Mrazek gave them a legitimate shot tonight in a game they had no business winning. And again, I totally agree with Alex here. Mrazek stopped a breakaway in the first period, shorthanded. That could have buried the Canes from the first 5 minutes of the game. And the last tweet here from @ThatCanesGuy, Jeb. By the way, I forgot to mention, Alex is @FutureCanes on Twitter. Just want to make sure I have that right in case you're watching this video and you want to go follow him. He is an excellent follow on Twitter for everything Canes related. From Jeb on this one, with almost six periods of hockey played, the Hurricanes as a team have not looked very good. There is a lot of work to be done. From watching the first two games so far of this season, I will say this much. It feels like I'm watching the exact same team from the bubble and the exact same team from January and February of last season, just playing hockey again. And if that's the case, there's a real big issue, and I think that comes to the coaching staff. I'm not going to sit and try to say it's Rod Brendamore's fault right now, but a lot of the time you have to start looking at a coach's system, and if a system is only being... The best comparable for this is Guy Boucher. Guy Boucher coached the Tampa Bay Lightning for a couple years, then he came back later on and coached the Ottawa Senators. He's a coach that has a 1-3-1 neutral zone trap system, plays that system, does not change that system, and once the system is figured out, it's over. That's why I believe he's coached in the league for a combined maybe 3.5 years over the span of like 10 years. Back to Brendamore for a second. If that's the case, that what's happening with his system is he is not evolving his system or changing or trying to shore up issues within his own system, we're going to start running into more problems than just losing games to the Detroit Red Wings. So that's going to do it, guys. On a final note, the two positive things, because I do want to keep this positive, the two positive things out of this game are going to be Svechnikov. Really, offensively, he's woken up to start the season, which is fantastic. The other aspect is Peter Mrazek. He's looked really, really good. My issue with Peter Mrazek has always been he so easily will get himself out of position and cannot stop the next shot. He's looked like a reserved goalie in his net. He's not coming out too much. He's not overplaying his angles. He's not challenging shooters too much. I've really liked what I've seen from Mrazek so far. And with that said, when we go and play Nashville, please just put Reimer in for the first game. See how the team plays in front of James Reimer. Anyways, guys, that's going to do it for this Canes game review episode number 2 of the season against Detroit. We'll be back with the next episode after the Nashville game on Monday or Tuesday. I don't know. All my days are mixed up. After the first game against Nashville and the 2-game series set there. Again, thank you guys so much for watching. Please click the like video or the like button down below and consider subscribing to the channel if you like Kane's content. And I will see you guys on the next one.